Shalom, Chavrim. I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Benoon Institute of Biblical Research, and probably we may air this here on Israeli News Live as well. I have no idea. But anyway, I wanted to share something with you guys. This is, it says on the screen here, Chapter Joseph, but that's not the actual chapter. It's a book I'm writing right now, and I haven't really said anything to anybody about it as of yet. I'm not going to speak about the title of the book right now. But I will say this, this book here will be a compilation of some amazing revelations that the Lord has given me over the years here about the identity of the Messiah. And specifically, I am hoping that it will help open the eyes of the Jewish people all around the world and even be a major blessing to the Christian community, the believers of Yeshua, about the identity of the Messiah himself. In the book, I do use the name Jesus. I use Yeshua as well. But the reason I do is because the book specifically will be reaching the hearts of the Jewish people. And when you say Jesus, without a question, they know exactly who you're talking about. If you say Yeshua, you have to remember that word means salvation in Hebrew. And sometimes they know what you mean and sometimes they don't. But when it comes to the name Jesus, they do. I make that clear throughout the book as it is. But I wanted to share something with you from one of the chapters that I'm writing on. And this is where, in the story of Joseph, I begin to use all those identifying traits that clearly point to the Messiah, and as well as other prophecies that were being fulfilled that have been completely overlooked by scholars as well as the Jewish community. And like I say, many believing scholars, Christians, have also missed out on some very key elements. Now, some of the things I will share in there that are obvious things that scholars have pointed out that identify Yeshua as being the Messiah. But I wanted to read to you specifically the beginning of this chapter right now entitled Joseph. It'll either be chapter 4 or 5, whatever the case may be. But when I'm writing, I just have to put it together the best way I can. I want to read to you here 2 pages from this book. You'll have to pardon some of the notes that are in there as I go along there, just so I know to add different parts. You'll see that in just a moment. And I don't know if you guys will be able to see this very well on the screen here. We will do it in high definition, so hopefully you'll be able to see it as well. But I'll just read to you, and I think it'll be a blessing to you because these are insights I have never shared before publicly. Something the Lord revealed to me recently, so that's why I wanted to share it with you today. So, all right, so I'm going to read to you from here, and I think it'll really be a blessing to you. The story of Joseph begins long before his birth, a story of betrayal and revenge and the fight of birthright that would become the signature of the woman's seed. Recorded by Moses in the book of Genesis, I will put enmity between thee and the woman and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head and thou shalt bruise his heel. Genesis 3:15. The birth of Esau and Jacob, the sons of Isaac and Rebekah, foreshadowed the identity of the seed of the serpent that would bruise the heel of God's anointed seed. When God when Jacob exited the womb, he took hold of his brother's heel, a very symbolic act identifying the image of Satan's seed that would bruise the heel of the Messiah. I believe it was a sign from God, though unknown to their parents, but Esau's descendants would produce the seed of the serpent. Many rabbinical scholars noted, as did the prophet Obadiah, that Esau's descendants ruled the Roman Empire. As Obadiah prophetically made clear, reference to the Titus, the Roman general, as recorded in the scroll that bears his name. In that day that thou stoodest on the other side, in the day that the strangers carried away captive his forces and foreigners entered into his gates and cast lots upon Jerusalem, even thou wast as one of them. Obadiah 1:11. Now keep in mind, the book will explain this later in detail as well, how that Esau's descendants end up intermingling among the Rephaim. In the days when Esau's descendants were all around the land of Israel there, they really began to embed among them. This was other things that happened that very much were displeasing his mother. And so we go into that a little bit later, and that's where that comes out at, as far as the seed of the serpent, which is part of the fallen angel race there that we read about over in the book of Enoch. But it goes on to say, we have clear reference by Daniel as well that the anointed prince would come before the destruction of Jerusalem. And it is no light matter that the Romans not only controlled the land of Israel before the destruction of the city, but also put to death the very man that many Israelites believe to be the fulfillment of Daniel's prophecy, Jesus of Nazareth. Going on, and there's another very interesting insight, I think, that will really bless your hearts, I wanted to share with you, that's in the book here. As Esau and his brother Jacob grew into men, it was obvious that Esau was beloved of his father, but Jacob was beloved of his mother. It was Rebekah that must have seen a special anointing on her son Jacob, and that he displayed the quality that would bring honor to the family. But tradition would have it, Isaac looked to his firstborn Esau to carry on the promise of God. Rebekah became desperate, and even at the cost of betrayal, she concocted a plan so that Jacob would be assured of the blessing. Her intuitive instinct no doubt knew it was Jacob that was God's chosen, and she fulfilled the trueness of the role given to women, Ezra Kanigido, a helper against him. That's recorded in Genesis chapter 3. When she made the bold decision to deceive Isaac into thinking Jacob was Esau. Jacob was reluctant and feared his brother's wrath and possible curse that he may have to incur if he carried out the plan of his mother to impersonate his brother. But Jacob was unaware that his mother Rebekah was being led by the Spirit of God. Jacob's destiny lay in the paths of prophecy, as his mother would help guide the hand of her husband Isaac. Being against him for the sake of her son would lead Jacob in the way of righteousness. Jacob obeyed his mother's command, and in betraying his brother, he received the blessing from his father, Esau. Esau, on the other hand, cared more for the belly and less for the birthright, and had long forgotten that his actions would now come to fruition. That's just a little bit of what I wrote in here. Have been moving along quite well in the book already. I'm hoping to have this book finished within the next 2 or 3 months here. A lot of information. I'll be looking at the types of Yeshua in the lives of Joseph, that of Moses, that of David, sharing insights there. I'll be sharing all types of insights, like the crown of thorns, walking on the water, many different insights that the Lord has revealed to me over the years here. And even at the end of the book, I'll be going into prophecies that are being fulfilled in modern times that are just really amazing that the Lord has been so kind to reveal to my heart. I hope and trust it'll be a blessing to you, and we will be keeping you up to date when that book comes out. And speaking of books, we have had a tremendous number of orders for the book Yom Suf. Again, just to remind you guys, which I think here on Dunedin Institute, you're not even aware of that as of yet, but those that watch Israeli News Live, we did a special broadcast there about the book Yom Suf that I wrote quite a number of years ago now, in fact. But a lot of people are unaware that I wrote this book. And the last chapter deals with Israel's final exodus and reveals a lot of those insights even in that chapter there. It's like a 100-page chapter. But we're going into this issue now and writing an in-depth book about all of these discoveries. And I'm just being blessed of the Lord and writing it, getting more and more revelation as I go. So I really hope that it'll be a blessing that you can share with your friends. And but as I was saying, not to get off course here, though, about the book Yom Suf, those of you that have ordered it, we had a lot of books here still. We sold out every one of those books there. We've already had to order in another shipment of books. We'll be mailing out everything that we had just sold here. So if you do not get the book, please be patient with us. The next shipment should be here next week. We'll get those all addressed and sent out. We are headed back to Europe and then over to Israel. We'll be departing at the 1st of March. We've already purchase tickets for that. And we're going to be doing some extensive work there in Europe. Yana will have to take a break from her treatment for about 1 week. Then she'll pick it back up in Europe. Your continued help in that effort is really needed. We did the campaign on GoFundMe of $10,000 for her, and her medical costs have far exceeded that already. And of course, there was many people that also helped as well directly on our website, israelinewslive.org, where you can contribute on there. So we want to thank you for those of you that have really helped in that area with her treatment. It has been a real blessing to be able to have that help with her medical expenses being so astronomical. But anyway, we are going to be heading over there. We're going into Israel, reaching out to the Jewish people there about the Messiah, and also be doing interviews in different parts of Europe as well, covering the very serious things that are going on over there. And your helping us making that trip would be really a blessing, because it is a major financial undertaking to have to fly there and then, of course, to fly back. Anyway, God bless you. Thank you for your love and support of this ministry. I'm Stephen Benoon with Israeli News Live and Benoon Institute here. Shalom.